material. So I'm very glad to be here and excited to share with you guys. I've been at KADLEC since 2009. I'm originally from California, but took my first job here, been very satisfied. It's been a great place to practice, and it's been great for my family. As I've gone along professionally, I had heard about this therapy initially in residency at the Mayo Clinic. There were a few doctors doing it, but it wasn't a formal part of our residency. Later on, as I would go to national meetings, I started hearing more about it. I got intrigued. And then probably about 2 years ago, I brought it to our clinic. I said, I really would like to get this going. I think it has a lot of value for people, you know, that we see every day. And so they've been very supportive. There's been a lot of energy and attention to kind of getting the process in place for people and getting it ready to basically serve you guys and help you with different aches and pains and, yeah, you know, improve to the best that we can. Speaking of that, I want to introduce some important people. We work as a team there, so I'm part of the KADLEC Neuroscience Center. You may be familiar. You can literally see our building. We're kind of diagonal there. That outpatient building on 1100 Gothels. It has cardiology, infectious disease, I think some other things. And we're down on the first floor of that building. So why don't you come on up? Ladies, come on up. All right. Yes? So this is my lovely team. We'll start with Melissa. So she's one of our medical assistants, and she does a great job, positive personality, very hard worker, and the medical assistants are so important, as you know, because I tell them, it's like, that's the first person the patient has contact with and the last person, right? It's the beginning and end of that visit, and I rely on them so much, and so I'm very grateful for them. So thank you, Melissa. We have Zulema, who's our referral coordinator. If you're interested in getting prolotherapy, you'll end up talking to her. We're going to have a booth set up out back, and she's the one who calls and actually schedules and gets everybody in an efficient way. So indispensable, and thank you for everything, Zulema. And we have Belen, and Belen is our other medical assistant. Again, very diligent, hard worker. I'm really blessed to have a great team right now, and so thankful for that. And we have Anissa, our manager of the Physical Medicine and Rehab Clinic, and she's been so helpful and so supportive to help get this going. So thank you very much, Anissa. There's been a lot of work done behind the scenes for it, so we're excited. So the ladies will be out in the back afterwards, for example, with some information as well as an opportunity to put your name down if you want to get called and scheduled for a consultation. Very quickly, the first initial consultation will be just like any regular office visit. It would be billed under insurance, nothing really special about it. You just say, you know, I want to come in and talk to Dr. Turner about my knee and prolotherapy or whatever the case is. At that time, we'll look through the particulars of your case, we'll look at the imaging, we'll talk through if it's an appropriate option for you or not. Okay? And then if it is, we'll move forward pretty quickly. We can get that injection done. Oftentimes, same day. So, just to let you guys know. Okay. Thanks, ladies. Okay. Well, here we go. So, prolotherapy, a regenerative injection for arthritis, ligaments, and tendons. Okay. And the key word here is regenerative. So this is a type of injection that actually stimulates healing in the body, it stimulates tissue growth, it stimulates regeneration. The best metaphor I can use is that it's like spot welding. That's what I describe it. It's like spot welding. You have a weak area of metal, you go in there, you weld it together, and things strengthen up. And that's the same idea that we accomplish through this injection. We find the area of the arthritis, the tendon pain, the muscle pull, the bursitis. We strengthen it up through a targeted injection. Have you guys ever seen an advertisement like this, perhaps? Okay. Yep. So I pulled this out of like a magazine on the back of an airplane, riding somewhere. And so it's got a picture. You see kind of off on the left, we got bone on bone here in the knee. And all of a sudden, we got cartilage regeneration. Look at that. And then it'll have like an, you know, the name and number of some orthopedic clinic or something like that. So my question is, you know, is this real? Is this a special x-ray that they kind of manipulated to make it look like there was cartilage there? Is this substantive or is it marketing hype? Right? That's what we're going to talk about. And turns out it actually is real. Some of the best studies for prolotherapy have been done in the knee. It's been demonstrated to tighten up the ligaments in the knee. It's been demonstrated to lay down new levels of cartilage in the knee as well. Let's talk about some definitions of problems. So that we can understand prolotherapy as a solution potentially to some of these problems. Okay, so we'll start off with tendonitis, and we'll start off with the question, what is a tendon, right? We all heard that word, but there's a precise definition to it, and it's worth keeping in mind. So every muscle in your body ultimately starts at a bone and then attaches at another bone somewhere. And the whole job of that muscle is to pull the bones closer together. The prototypical example, let's just say, is your biceps muscle, right? So you've got it attaching to your shoulder, and you've got it attaching down to your arm, and then that muscle contracts, and those bones kind of get pulled closer together. Interestingly, the muscle does not have the same structure from one end of the bone to the other. It's not homogeneous. It doesn't look the same. It doesn't act the same. It's not built the same. The middle part of the muscle is nice and red and beefy and has a lot of blood flow and is thick, as in, for example, your bicep muscle. Looks something like that, right? Okay. But on the ends where it attaches to the bones, it changes structure. It changes structure entirely. It thins down. You get rid of a lot of the blood vessels. You have more layers of collagen in there. It becomes denser. Think of it more like a cord almost, okay? And then that attaches to the bone. That has pros and cons. It's much stronger as far as tensile strength. So as you lift with a biceps tendon, it's very hard to snap that tendon. The structure of all that collagen, the denseness to it, and the way it's all interwoven, it's like a cord with three strands, just to put an image in your mind, right? So that's very strong, it's very powerful, and it holds tightly onto that bone. It also doesn't take up much space. The muscle thins down, right? The downside is there's not great blood flow, and therefore it's hard to heal, okay? Anywhere you don't get blood flow, you will not get healing. The things go hand in hand. For example, that's why diabetes can cause healing problems, because diabetes is a blood sugar problem which inhibits the blood flow. It's kind of like sludge builds up in the blood vessels. Body parts don't get enough blood flow, and then wounds don't heal, as an example. And then people have to get feet or legs amputated in the worst case scenario. So you have to have good blood flow in order to get healing. A tendon does not have good blood flow. Although it's strong, if it is damaged, it's hard to heal it, okay? It takes a while. It's going to take some aggressive physical therapy, and even then it might kind of plateau. All right? So let's look at the Achilles tendon. This example, here comes your calf muscle, right, coming down your leg, and then all of a sudden it thins out and morphs and changes shape into this Achilles tendon and attaches to your heel. Okay, well, let's ask a couple questions. Can that tendon, like, partially tear off your heel?
Yes.
Yes. Can it entirely snap off your heel?
Yeah.
Okay. Could it split like that?
Yes.
Could it rub across and fray?
Yes.
Okay, yes. All those things happen, and all those things will create pain. And you'll be limping, you'll have a gimpy Achilles tendon. If it's completely popped off the bone, that's a surgical situation, okay? The orthopedic will reattach it, and you'll be like in a walking boot with a little scooter, you know, one of those types of things for about a couple months. Maybe some of you have had that. Otherwise, though, it's actually not a surgical situation. If it's partially torn off, if it's frayed, if it's splitting, there's no surgery to do on it. It's already attached. But what we have to do is try to strengthen that area, right? And so we try through physical therapy, but prolotherapy, as an example, is something that can come in and help strengthen up that area. Let's go to another example. Let's talk about a ligament. What is a ligament? Let's think of the prototypical example as your ankle, okay? We've all heard of a sprained ankle, right? What is a sprained ankle? It just means that the ankle ligaments have been damaged. The ankle ligaments are the same toughness, density, collagen, and such as the tendons for the most part. You can think of them as the same. The only difference is they never were a part of a muscle. It's just pure connective tissue from one bone to another bone, right? So when you see that ankle ligament, you don't see red beefy muscle up there, right? It's just connective tissue. The way I describe it a lot of times, it's like cobwebs, okay? So around your ankle, you have this dense network of cobwebs, essentially, fibrous connective tissue going back and forth in like a cross-hatched pattern to help hold the bones together and give you stability. Sounds good? Same pros and cons. It helps keep the ankle stable, but if it's injured, it can be hard to heal because it doesn't get good blood flow, okay? And you can twist your ankle, and those ligaments can stretch, which will hurt. They can partially tear. They can snap off bones. All that kind of thing can happen. Let's talk about arthritis. Okay, what is arthritis? Well, arthritis in its final definition is damage to the cartilage of the joint. Okay, damage to the cartilage of the joint. The joint, so let's look at the knee, for example. This is a picture of a knee. So this would be your knee if you're sitting here, and then the patient like sat down in a chair and their knee opened up. You with me? Like 90 degrees, something like this. Okay. The way I like to describe it, it's like a putting green of a golf course, right? You've got a nice putting green, and then you've got putting green that has divots out of it, right? Arthritis is there's been wearing away of that cartilage, as you see in the picture. There's divots taken out of that cartilage, and now the bone underneath is exposed. It might bleed a little bit. It's definitely rough. It will hurt. And in response to that, the body will start to lay down calcium molecules, almost like a callus building up, and so then you get bone spurs. So if you've heard about bone spurs, it's just a reactive phenomenon to the cartilage being worn out a little bit, and the body's trying to cope with it the best it can. So that's arthritis. This slide right here is probably the most important slide of the entire talk. Okay, it looks simple, but this is the whole concept of prolotherapy. It's the whole concept of healing in your body, and it's the most important slide of the whole talk. So we'll start off on our left side here. It says inflammation, okay, and it says 4 to 6 days. This is basically the healing process that happens in your body. So let's say you have a cut. That's a good example. For the first 4 to 6 days, you have some inflammation, which is perceived by the patient as some soreness, some swelling, some redness, right? The key fact that happens then is that platelets come in, a blood clot gets formed, and it kind of stabilizes the wound. So you're no longer bleeding, and there's no longer infection, you know, other materials coming into the body. So it kind of stabilizes it. That's your first little phase. The second phase, if you can't read this, I apologize, the font's a little small. It's called proliferation. Okay? This is the phase where the healing really gets going. And so proliferation, those cells in that area, they secrete little signaling molecules, which we call growth factors. And then those growth factors percolate out in the bloodstream, and they attract stem cells, which you have probably heard about. That's in the news a lot, right? And then the stem cells come in. And the way I describe the stem cells is like they're the general contractors. Okay? They get attracted to the work site, and they start bossing people around, telling them what to do, and they start putting spackle on the walls and painting stuff and throwing up trim and 2x4s and so forth. Okay, so they're rebuilding. That can go on for about 3 weeks. All right. So 1 week, let's just think of it as 1 week is your, you know, inflammatory process, blood clot, initial healing. Then about 3 weeks, proliferation starting to happen, growth factors, stem cells, work's getting done. And then, after about 3 weeks, it's all been deposited. All the spackle's on the wall, you know, all the gross structure, the hole in the wall is fixed. But it's not done yet. There's an important part that still needs to be done, and that's what we call remodeling. So this last phase, this big purple hump, is remodeling. Think about this as like the finish work, right? Someone's got to come in and sand down the spackle. Someone's got to repaint it nicely, make sure, you know, everything is melded up, and kind of polish it up nicely, right? And that's the same thing that happens in the body. When you have, let's say, a tear in your ankle ligament, you get some rebuilding of that collagen, but then it's almost like you have to tell the body where to put the collagen and how to line up in an optimal way. If you do not do that, you get what we call disorganized collagen deposition. And that's not a good thing. Disorganized collagen is weak. We want organized collagen, which lines up along lines of force. Again, think about like your three-stranded rope. That's organized, right? We need those fibers organized. We don't want just fibers in every different direction. So that last part, the remodeling, is vital because you're organizing everything along lines of stress in the body, which means you have to move it and use it. So your ankle may be sitting there with some fresh ligaments, but they have to be lined up, they have to be organized, and that's where rehabilitation comes in. That's where physical therapy, exercise. That's literally the only way to tell that body where the line of stress is and how it needs to line up. Making sense? Here's the good news about this. This is actually a good news situation. You'll notice it says remodeling. How long does this go on? Well, starting at week 3, but then at the end of this little graph here, it says 2 years. Oh my word. Wow. So something's still remodeling up to 2 years later? Yes, that's true. And actually, that's a positive thing. So what does that mean? That means if you had a badly sprained ankle 6 months ago, and you're thinking, ah, it's still kind of painful, I went to therapy, I'm done with therapy, you know, maybe it just is what it is. No, the body's still waiting there for more signals. It's got 2 years to really finish up on that process, right? So stay with it. And this remodeling part is something that you control, again, through therapy, exercises, things like that. So you can keep putting in that work, keep showing that body what to do. It will keep remodeling for up to 2 years after an injury. So I like that. I like that. It's a very positive thing. Prolotherapy comes in on the far left side here and kickstarts this process. Okay? It turns on switches, it fires it up, it ignites it, and it starts this whole process, which then moves across the screen, right, towards ultimately remodeling and better function of the tissue. So when we come in and we do our injection, we're doing some things that create some inflammation, we're trying to create release of growth factors, and we're just getting the process started. Okay. What is prolotherapy? The prefix prolo is the idea of proliferation. That's what it's trying to convey. Right? So we're trying to get proliferation of tissue and therefore healing. The nice part about this injection is people often ask, well, does the shot wear off or how long will it last? Right? And the nice part is it doesn't wear off. Okay, it lasts forever. You give a shot and you stimulate a certain level of healing and then you're just there. You're at your new level. It doesn't fall off. It's there. Now, it may not have totally solved your problem. Your problem might have been up here. You might have had a big mountain to climb. Okay? So we do a shot, maybe you feel 50% better. That's fine. But you're not going to lose that 50% ever. You don't have to repeat the shot. The body's healed up to that degree. Maybe we need to do another shot and try to get some additive benefit, perhaps. But that's the great part about this injection. Plenty of people, I would say 35% of people, get better enough after one injection. Okay? There's factors that depend on that, obviously how severe, you know, the injury is and the overall health status of the individual. But plenty of people get enough benefit where they feel cured, essentially, minimal problem, after just one injection in a spot. That's kind of helpful. Oh, there we go. Let's talk about the history of it for a minute. So here we have a guy throwing a javelin. So in a sense, the idea of prolotherapy can go all the way back to like the ancient Greeks and the Olympic Games. Okay? And of course, we still have javelin around as a contest, right? Well, you can imagine these javelin throwers, this is a lot of strain and stretch through the ligaments of the shoulder, right? In fact, their shoulders would dislocate sometimes, which is a severe injury, hard to fix it. You can pop the shoulder back in, but those ligaments are still torn and they're weak and they're loose, right? And therefore the shoulder becomes unstable. It's prone to dislocating again. It's really not fixed. It's just sitting in there and it's still very weak and debilitated, right? So the question was, how can we tighten up these guys' shoulders? And I don't know where they came up with the idea, but it was basically jamming a hot poker in there, okay? Like a branding iron, basically, and searing that meat and tightening up the front of the shoulder. Oh, I mean, imagine, right? Very uncomfortable, yeah. But it was very effective. It was very effective. And interestingly enough, in orthopedics nowadays, they do a variation of the same idea, actually. They'll take you in with an arthroscopy. They can go down in there on those ligaments, and they do some kind of procedures where they like coagulate them and heat them up and try to get them to tighten up, actually. Then we move along. Let's talk about hernia, all right? What's a hernia? It's basically a bulge of your intestine, right? We all can imagine that. You got a little bulge sitting there. You cough, you sneeze, it hurts, and it may bulge out. Well, why is it bulging? You know, it should not be, right? So why is it bulging? The answer is because there's been a weakness in your abdominal wall. That's the fundamental problem. The problem is not really your intestine. The problem is your abdominal wall is weak, and the tissue down there, which we call the fascia, okay, has torn, and a space has opened up, and now stuff's popping out through that space. You with me? So that's what we're trying to show here on this diagram, right? You got this connective tissue that's pretty thin in there, and all of a sudden we got a hole in it that has occurred. All right. So the basic solution at a root level for a hernia is not really with the intestine, it's repairing the hole. So you push the intestine back inside, but then you have to do something about the hole, right? Now, nowadays we have mesh surgery, which works pretty well overall, right? Sometimes there's some issues with it, but overall it's a nice surgery. So they'll go in there, they'll put a mesh over there, and they'll fix that hole. That's great. Mesh surgery didn't always exist, right? What were they doing in the older days? What they were doing in the older days was they were injecting that area with something similar to the concept of prolotherapy to try to stimulate some healing and some tightening of that connective tissue in your abdominal wall. That's what they were doing. And they were actually getting quite successful with it to the point that I'm going to show you. Oh. I don't have the quote here, but I'll paraphrase it. There was a quote from like a surgical journal back in 1937, and it said basically that we have the injection solutions have reached such a degree of benefit for patients that we rarely need to do surgery on hernias anymore. Yeah, and that was in 1937. So that was amazing. Now, since then, the surgery has advanced, I would say, with the mesh and all that, and that's a good thing. But compared to the surgery that was being done at the time, the injections had advanced to the point that surgery was not necessary in most cases. So, very interesting concept. Prolotherapy, as far as what we're talking about with healing muscles and tendons and ligaments and things, really got going in the 1950s. And the key name is, at the top, Dr. Hackett. And Dr. Hackett was an interesting guy. He was from Canton, Ohio, and he was a trauma surgeon, actually. And so he worked in the ER a lot. He saw a lot of trauma. And trauma typically is going to involve back and neck pain, as you could imagine, right? People fall off ladders, car accidents, this and that. So he ended up treating a lot of back and neck pain. And it's a little bit lost in obscurity how he hit on the idea of using what he did use, which was a solution called dextrose, to actually be the prolotherapy injection. It's a little shrouded in mystery, but he was started to use dextrose prolotherapy, and he started to inject it along the ligaments in people's neck for classic whiplash type problem, right? Or in the ligaments in their back, and he started to see a lot of dramatic relief. Okay? A lot of dramatic relief. So here's an example. This picture here is of your neck and your head. This would be if you're looking like this at the side of my face and my neck. You with me? So your skull's sitting up here, you got the side of the neck here, and then the back, you see all these dense white fibers? Those are ligaments right there in the back of your head. When we think about ligaments, we usually don't think of the neck, right? Average person probably thinks of your knee ligaments or your ankle ligaments, which is understandable. You have some thick ligament structures along the back of your spine, which also makes sense. You have your head. Your head is it weighs as much as a bowling ball. If your head's snapping around, something's got to hold the spine together so you don't have segments popping off, right? So your spine has a dense connective tissue layer, several layers of these ligaments, including ones out here on the surface. So he was basically finding the soreness right across the middle of someone's neck, injecting those ligaments with the dextrose prolotherapy, noting a lot of benefit. Okay, similar concept here. This is a picture of your low back. This is if you're looking straight behind someone like this, and so your pelvis is over here on the left, and then your other side of your pelvis is right over here. You with me? Do you guys see all these gigantic ligaments back there? Right? Your typical person doesn't realize this, but if you lifted, if you were in anatomy class, you lifted off all the muscle and stuff, you see these gigantic things look like ropes and cables, very dense network in there. Stands to reason, that's connecting your spine to your lower body, right? Somewhere your spine has to connect to your lower body, and you hope it's a strong connecting point, right? And so that's what this is all about. We have a tremendously strong and multifaceted series of ligaments through all that area. The most notable ones are called the sacroiliac ligaments. If you've ever heard of that, some of you might have been diagnosed with like a sacroiliac joint problem or something. That's very common. So you get in an accident, your spine snapping around, it can stretch those ligaments, as you imagine. They can tear, they can hurt. So Dr. Hackett was doing injections in those sacroiliac ligaments and up on the neck and getting a lot of good results. Dr. Hemwall came along and met him at a national conference. Was much younger. He was a student at the time. And so he kind of picked up his work and he popularized it, did a lot of research on it, and really raised it to another level of professionalism and awareness and dissemination. Okay? And so he actually started doing some work with rabbit tendons, which I'll show you in a second, injecting them, measuring how much bigger and stronger they got, and basically documented that you can do prolotherapy with dextrose safely. In the office setting, doesn't require general anesthesia, doesn't require an operating room, nothing like that. It can be done safely, it's effective. Even a primary care doctor could do it, which I think he was a primary care doctor. And then, oh, thank you. A famous book came out basically in the 50s called Tendon and Ligament Relaxation, Treated by Prolotherapy. All right? And this was like the groundbreaking textbook, and it's still in print, and people still talk about it at national conferences. Here's the rabbit tendons from Dr. Hackett. On this side, we have some untreated tendons, right and left. I think this is Achilles tendon of the rabbit. Okay? And then over here, we have treated by prolotherapy, right and left. Look at this right tendon, look at this right tendon. Does this look beefier to you? Yeah. So, you know, actually, when they cut the thing open and made measurements and all that stuff, it has 60% greater diameter. So he was able to show that you could inject rabbit tendons, plump them up by 60%, cut them out, see it, measure it from dextrose prolotherapy. Let's get up to the present time, 2007, the New York Times. Injections to kickstart tissue repair. Interesting. It was all about prolotherapy. You guys recognize this face?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I grew up with him, so I was a kid in the 80s, and I don't know how, but I knew who the Surgeon General was, I guess, and so I always liked this guy. I mean, he looked cool. He always had a bow tie, and he was real calm and real friendly. He kind of reminded me of Mr. Rogers, I guess, essentially. You know, like, just a great personality. This guy had a great personality. So what's interesting is that this is C. Everett Koop, former Surgeon General under Ronald Reagan, okay? At age 40, he was diagnosed with some incurable chronic pain. Wasn't working, going towards disabled, incurable chronic pain. He heard about Dr. Hackett and met up with him and started getting some prolotherapy injections that basically revolutionized his life and function, needless to say, and allowed him to carry on in his career. It was so impactful for him that he has a quote I'm going to share with you. This is how impactful it is. I was so impressed with what prolotherapy could do for musculoskeletal disease that I at one time thought that might be the way I would spend my years after formal retirement from the University of Pennsylvania. But the call of President Reagan to be Surgeon General of the United States interrupted my plans. Okay. So, he was a budding prolotherapy doctor before he became Surgeon General. Pretty cool. I don't know if you recognize this face. This guy's got a big gold medal on his neck. This is the U.S. ski team member, male or woman, male or female, who has won more medals than anybody else in history. He retired a few years ago. His name's Bodie Miller, if you've heard this name. Bodie Miller. Okay, he's from New Hampshire. Okay? His career was saved and revitalized on the basis of prolotherapy to his knees. And he's on record talking about this. He got interviewed on ESPN. It's all over the internet. This was probably about 10 years or so ago. But it caused a big splash because Bodie Miller came out and said, I could never have competed in these Olympics and won a gold if it weren't for this prolotherapy shot that I got. He actually went down to Mexico to get it. And he worked with a very famous doctor named Dr. Ong Lee, who's an interesting guy, basically from New Zealand, and kind of a different type of guy and kind of needed his own space. And so he went down to this little hokey clinic in Ensenada, Mexico. It doesn't look like anything, but he is a top-line prolotherapy guy. And all of a sudden, all these U.S. ski team members were finding out how to get to him because the word was spreading, right? So Bodie Miller went and saw this doctor in Mexico and, you know, got this shot and all of a sudden got his career back on track, okay? And then a bunch of the U.S. ski team guys started going down there. So big, big success there. So, inquiring minds want to know, all right? So let's ask a few questions here. Why haven't you heard about it? All right, fair enough. The reason you haven't heard about it is because there's no strong profit motive in it. Okay. That's the bottom line. Right? So, we have a profit-focused healthcare system for the most part. Now, it's got its pros, but it has its cons, too. If there's no money in something, right, there's not going to be an organization created to promote it, disseminate it, pay people to tell about it, put advertising on TV for it, et cetera, and so forth. There's no money in prolotherapy because there's no technology that's patentable, there's no hardware that we're putting in the body, there's no fancy medication. It's numbing medicine and it's dextrose, which is a sugar solution, okay? That's it. It's a sugar water injection in plain English, if you want to say that. But it's powerfully effective. We know that. At a certain concentration of sugar, the cells respond with a significant elevation of their growth factors. It's a significant stimulation towards growth and healing. And we figured that out. So at this right concentration, dextrose is a powerful stimulation. But, as I said, there's no profit motive in it. The little quote I like is that very famous sort of conundrum, which is, if a tree falls in the woods, right, and nobody hears it, does it make any sound?
Yeah.
It's the same concept. If prolotherapy is an amazing, effective treatment, but nobody's there to publicize it, does it make any sound? That's why you haven't heard of it. Also, there were several reports early on in the 50s of some spinal complications that kind of like cast a cloud on it, put a damper on it. It was being popularized and people were enthusiastic, and the injection techniques really hadn't been codified and professionalized yet. And so there were some cases where people went too deep around the spine and people got infections and then they had some spinal cord issues. And so it only takes, you know, one or two of those cases to come out in a new therapy for doctors to get very skittish. And the medical system tends to be very conservative overall because it's all about, you know, is someone going to sue me? And if I am accused of something, what are my peers going to say? So there's a herd mentality that's very strong within medicine. Now, is that good or bad? Well, it's good because it keeps things on the safer side, but it's bad as far as advancement, right? Because with the herd mentality, everything stays at the most common and safe level, right? It's hard to get going. So there's things that we know that are good, but doctors don't necessarily want to do them because someone's going to think I'm a quack, and if this gets into court, you know, who's going to defend me on it, and this and that. So that's unfortunate, but that's the reality. So that cast a pall over it for a while in the 50s. It's not patentable. It's not high tech. We talked about that. Insurance doesn't pay for it. Why not? Well, interestingly, Medicare doesn't pay for it, and so others follow suit to a large degree. Okay? It's like monkey see, monkey do. It's like we have all the bureaucrats in Medicare to figure out what they're going to pay for it. Why do we need to hire our own team of bureaucrats? We'll just take their findings. If they don't pay for it, we're not going to pay for it either. Simple as that. Now, how ironic is it that the former Surgeon General of the United States was cured by prolotherapy and said he would have been doing that if he weren't Surgeon General, but Medicare doesn't pay for it? It's highly ironic, you know, in my mind. Okay. Inquiring minds want to know, it sounds too good to be true. This is a very legitimate barrier, right? We all should have some natural skepticism about what we're doing to our bodies and new treatments, and, you know, not everything that's hyped up and promoted has really the value that it should have for patients. And I'm actually the first person to think that way too. I have to walk a line, right? I have to walk a line between being open-minded, considering that something might be new that I've never heard of, it might be helpful, but also being skeptical and researching it and make sure the value is really there for my patients, right? So, in some sense, it sounds too good to be true. It's like, oh, really? You don't need knee surgery? You could just have a sugar water shot in your knee and your ligament's gonna get tight, you know? And then the orthopedic surgeon is scoffing at the idea, right? So that's a legitimate barrier. But all I can say is it is true. And so, you know, hopefully in the right case, you can experience that it's true and get some relief. Let's deal with a couple examples. And just before I get to this, I want to give kind of a final overview. I'm going to talk for maybe 5 or 10 more minutes. Then we have actually a couple of prolotherapy patients of mine here today. They're going to share their experience. And then we're going to open it up for a Q&A, maybe like 10 minutes. They'll stay up here. So if you want to ask the patient a question, that's great. If you want to ask me a question, that's great. And then we'll kind of formally end on time at 2. And I may be able to stay around for an extra 10 minutes or something like that. Okay? That's kind of where we're going here. So here's an example. 65-year-old woman with a chronic ankle sprain that would not heal. This was my mother-in-law. All right. So she went to therapy for a long time. The ankle got kind of better, but not totally. All right. Every time she would walk uphill, it would throb. This was really getting her down. She wasn't able to do her exercise program. She was gaining a little bit of weight. She's not feeling as active. Her mood was starting to tank. Right? It became a real problem. And this drug on for probably 7-8 months. I kept hearing about this, you know, talking to my wife and going to visit and stuff like that. I said, you know what? Can I just please do prolotherapy on this? It's magic for ankle sprains that won't heal. It's just, there's no other word for it. It's astounding. You go right on those ligaments, they tighten up, people's ankles, they're like spring chickens again with their ankle. And so I said, I kind of like convinced her because she has a needle phobia and stuff. I'm like, just let me do a shot on this thing, you know. So we used a lot of numbing medicine and held her down pretty much. And then we gave her the shot. So if you can see here, right, we got all these ligaments around the ankle. We got to tighten these things up. So that's just exactly what we did. She did great. Outstanding. One shot, she was happy. Was done. She doing her aerobics class. She walking up hills. Her mood's back. She's feeling great. So sprained ankle, ligaments. Okay. 21-year-old man with chronic foot pain after basketball. So he's a pretty active guy. He's just playing recreational basketball at college and kind of landed hard on his foot, and the foot just started throbbing. Went to physical therapy for a while, wasn't getting better. Got an MRI. Excuse me. Got an MRI. MRI looked normal, completely normal. Orthopedic surgeon's like, hey, there's a normal MRI here. There's nothing for me to do surgery on. I'm sorry. I don't know what to tell you. I guess keep using your crutches. Keep using your boot. and give it a little more time. Well, that went on for like 6 more months. Now he's getting frustrated, right? He's 21. This is going on a year. I mean, he didn't break anything. Why isn't he getting better, right? First of all, it shows you the limitations of an MRI. It's a great tool, but it does have its limitations. If a ligament or tendon is stretched, it will look normal on an MRI. If it's got some small tears, it will look normal on an MRI. An MRI does not see pain, okay? The body can perceive pain. So understand that your body's perception of pain is like several layers higher and more comprehensive than what an MRI could show. And a good doctor will know things that can cause pain that are visible on an MRI and things that can cause pain that are invisible on an MRI, right? And that's our job to know that distinction. So I understand that there are plenty of category of ligament and tendon problems that will hurt, but they won't create damage that's grossly visible on an MRI. The only time it would be visible on MRI is if it's really snapped in two and there's a bunch of swelling or bleeding or something like that. If you got two tendon pieces flapping there, you'll see that. Or a large tendon in the body like Achilles or a rotator cuff with a big tear in it, that's fine. Little ankle ligaments and stuff and things in your foot. Again, see all these little ligaments between the bones of your foot? That was his problem. It was kind of up here in what we call the forefoot area, right? It was just stretched. It was just painful. You could put your finger right on the spot. It wasn't a medical mystery. It was like right under my finger is the guy's problem. And every time he would put pressure on it, his foot would flex down, and that little spot would just stretch, and it would hurt. Wasn't getting better. So we did a shot on him. Did well. Real happy. Done. 68-year-old male with shoulder pain. This is actually one of our patients we're going to talk to today. So, he was having some problem kind of over here on the front of his shoulder, right? Now, this muscle right here, this is your biceps. Looking like this. This is the meaty part of the biceps muscle. Here's what's interesting. Your biceps has two parts. I mean, you could probably figure that out from the prefix bi, right? But it plays very much into your shoulder. It has an essential and important role in the shoulder. A lot of people don't realize that. So one of the tendons snakes right up the front of your shoulder. And every time you lift your shoulder up like this, it's actually your bicep tendon doing work. Okay? And so the most common cause for anterior shoulder pain right here that you could put your finger on is actually a biceps tendon problem. Why don't you just feel right here, by the way. Take a finger. You should be able to roll back and forth like left to right and feel a little tendon or rope underneath your finger. Okay? Most likely you can. That's that tendon sitting right there in a little groove. Okay? And it might be sore on you. Okay? It's a common area. It's sitting in a groove. It snaps around. It kind of gets dinged up. It gets frayed. It gets a little stretched. Anterior shoulder pain right here that you can put your finger on, this is a biceps tendon problem. Very common. Doesn't need surgery in most cases unless it's snapped in half and hanging there, right? Even then, once it snaps in half, it's like your muscle rolls down. Have you ever seen people like that? Uh-huh. Right? They'll say, like, I tore my biceps, and they have a little Popeye ball of muscle sitting here because one of those tendons snapped and it just rolled right back up. The surgeons still usually don't do anything about it, right? It's hard to like pull that thing out, you know, unroll it, reattach it. They usually just leave it alone because you lose strength, but your shoulder can still function. So you maybe lose 30-40%, but you can still lift your arm. So most people are standing around with a torn biceps tendon, and it's kind of rolled up in their arm, if you've ever seen this. It's a pretty notable thing to when you see it. So biceps tendon can be common. We did a shot. This gentleman got a lot better. And last one I'll mention, this person had low back pain. Again, if you go back to this drawing, you see all those ligaments in the low back, right? Connecting your spine to your lower body. Very important, thick, dense network here. This gentleman was having pain every time he'd go to work, pain walking his dog, bending over, things like that. It was his sacroiliac ligaments, which are kind of right in here on either side. That was a problem. Couple of shots for him, in this case twice, was feeling good. Said, thank you, doc. Never seen him back. He's working. He's doing well. Let me go over the details, and then we're going to wrap up. So I would say overall, to throw out a number, right? I would say a cure rate of 80%, right? So this has to do with making sure it's an appropriate problem for prolotherapy. That's why we talk together. If it's an appropriate problem, the prolotherapy has a very high chance of curing that problem. I would give it 80% chance. That's cure. Significant improvement, I would say probably that gets higher, even up to 95. So the 95 would be people like, I feel better. I definitely feel better. It's not gone, but it's better, right? And if we'd usually do a max of 3 or 4 injections because at that point you stimulate the area to the max that it can be. It's like you plateau on your curve, right? So some people will get to their 3 or 4 shots and they're not 100%. Granted. But significantly better, yeah, a high degree of them. The cost is $300 per injection, typically not covered by insurance. Just to put this in context, this is actually a great price. It's actually very affordable. Our clinic staff worked really hard to come up with a fair price for ourselves. If you went to Seattle or Portland, it'd be like $600 or $700. Okay? It's no different shot that we're doing here. It's just they priced it out to make it accessible as best we can. How many injections? I think I talked about that. About 30% are cured after one injection, and then we go up to a max of 3 or 4. That's the most that we would do. And we do them a month apart, right? So we kickstart a healing process that spreads, and then we follow up with you in 30 days to see where you're at, right? If you still need, you know, if you responded to the shot but not totally, then we can consider doing another one. So 30-day intervals is how we work that. Okay, are the options worth it? Well, if you compare it to surgery, the cost is trivial. Surgery can be avoided by prolotherapy. I've seen plenty of cases. I had a lady who was in her late 70s who was told she needed a shoulder replacement. And she got 100% after a few prolotherapy shots. No shoulder replacement needed. She's in my office smiling, going like this, and wants to give me a big hug. Right? So that was dramatic, and that was cool. It's non-invasive. There's no downtime as far as recovery. That's a nice part of this. You have surgery, you're going to have some downtime, right? You're going to have your arm wrapped up in a sling or this and that. Prolotherapy, we actually want you to be active because we have to remodel that area, right? So it's an active recovery process. Prolotherapy is best when it's followed up by some exercises. So I always go over that with people. Either getting them on a high-quality physical therapy program or showing them some home exercises to do because those work together for synergy of optimal healing. Who should not get it? Well, if you have significant difficulty healing, let's say if you're a smoker, bad diabetes, you're on drugs that suppress your immune system, it's going to decrease your ability to respond to prolotherapy. Okay, it will. It's not absolute that you cannot. Again, just think of the concept of surgery. Do they do people on surgery with this? Do they do surgery on people with these problems? Yes. Can a smoker, a diabetic, or someone on immune drugs still like heal from their surgery? Yes. Right? But it's harder. The complication rate is higher. So this is just something to keep in mind. It kind of blunts the expectations a little bit as I go over things with patients. But you can still heal. The risk? The nice part is there's no intrinsic risk any more than just any injection, right? The sugar water solution is as safe and benign as it can be. It's not even a problem as far as if you had diabetes and you're wondering about your blood sugar. It doesn't raise it. Because we're talking just several milliliters here. The only risks of the injection are, you know, depending on where we're doing it. So if we're near blood vessels and nerves and such like that, we just have to pay attention, as in any injection, to where you're putting your needle. Is this for me? Let's just hit some key words here at the end, okay? Pulled muscle. Arthritis. Tendonitis. Bursitis. Okay, there we go. So, we're going to have, and thank you very much, a couple of my patients have come today. So, George and Joan, let's come on up. Let's get this thing on. This is always my favorite part. Is this on?
Yeah.
Hello. Okay. Let's start with you. You want to share your experience with us?
My name is Joan.
Put it up your mouth.
Excuse me. Is it on?
Yeah, it is.
All right. My name is Joan. I had bursitis in my left hip. It was very painful, a lot during the day, but mostly at night when I would try to sleep. I'm a side sleeper, so when I would lay on my left side, it would always wake me up, and my quality of sleep was very much diminished. I tried physical therapy, did not work. In fact, it became more painful with the physical therapy. So I heard about Dr. Turner through my daughter because she had her shoulder operated on and she was having a lot of discomfort and wanted to try the prolotherapy because she had done a lot of research. So I went with her to her visit with Dr. Turner and visited with him about my hip issues, and he recommended the injection. And I had the first injection a year ago, this past November. It worked wonderful. I did really well for a long time, and it started bothering me again this summer. Kept putting it off, even though I was in pain. Finally, I went back in August, had another injection, and my hip is 90-95% better. I do the exercises. Dr. Turner gave me 5 exercises to do, simple exercises, and I continue to do those. And I have been very well pleased with it, and thank Dr. Turner.
Dr. Turner was my savior in many ways to return my lifestyle back to the kind of activities that I was doing. My wife and I are kayakers. We like also to do ballroom dancing. And both of those activities had come actually to an end for me because of shoulder pains and some issues I had with my ankles. And so for the most part, I was planning to do another one of those life season shifts, as you well know what they might be like. After I saw Dr. Turner and he gave me just one injection on this shoulder, I went home, and 4 days later, I noticed that I was pain-free. 4 days prior to seeing him, I could not lift a carton of milk at arm's length. It was that bad. So I was feeling so pain-free, so I thought, I'm going to see if I can lift that carton of milk, and I did. And then I said, well, I'm going to see if I can lift my hedge trimmer. And I was so amazed that 4 days after the injection, I was trimming the hedges in my house overhead. I couldn't believe it. I had to call him and tell him. Mm-hmm. Yes, we both rejoiced, didn't we?
Yeah.
And then after that, I said, all right, doctor, how about my dancing? So he looked at several areas on my ankle, did the same thing, and it was as miraculous as the first time. And I think that Dr. Turner says that my body likes sugar water. So I have become such a believer in this treatment that anyone that I meet that has any type of a pain, of joint pain, must absolutely pick up the phone and talk to this wonderful doctor in town. And I would encourage every one of you to do similarly with yourselves and with your loved ones and your friends, because truly, you know, when I take my automobile to a mechanic, no matter what he does, it's $300 out the window immediately, right? And your body is far more important than an automobile. And the success rate that Dr. Turner has mentioned, it is really that high, at least from those persons that I know that yes. have benefited from this. And so thank you, doctor, and I hope that you will continue promoting it and that more and more individuals will have their life rejuvenated.
Great.
As I have. Thank you.
Sure, brother. Thank you. If you guys want to stay for a second, George, sorry, if you just stay for a second, we're going to do some Q&A. And so, for example, if you had a question of either of them, we can hand the microphone back and forth, that kind of thing. So, go ahead, sir. Mm-hmm.
In your presentation, you mentioned the word stem cell one time.
Yes.
How does this correlate with stem cell injections versus the sugar water?
Huh? So the question was about stem cells and how that compares to prolotherapy. So stem cell injections, can you hold that for me? Stem cell injections are helpful. They kind of come in on that second phase. The problem, I would say, is that they're very expensive, and they can be ineffective sometimes if the initial phase isn't really kicked off. So when I go to the national meetings and talk to people who are doing stem cells, they always do either some prolotherapy with it, which is kind of your stage 1, to get things going, or what they call PRP injection, which you may have heard about too. So stem cells will work best if there's PRP or prolotherapy initially to kick things off. And then, if your body doesn't have enough stem cells, for example, to come in and heal a situation, they can augment that. Stem cells alone will have less chance of success if the first section, if you will, or phase isn't going. And also, they're fairly expensive. So that's my take on it. But there's validity to it, for sure.
Are there ones that are $1,000?
Yeah, something like that. Maybe $1,000 or something more.
Yeah. Lots more than that. So you said the cost is $300 per injection.
Yes.
Earlier, you also said something about the appointment being just like a doctor's appointment.
Yeah.
Is the appointment time covered by insurance?
Yes. So the question is that initial appointment covered by insurance? Yes. It's just like any other doctor visit appointment.
But you have to follow the get a referral from your primary care?
Great question. Do you have to have a referral from your primary care? This is an outstanding question. The answer is no. We are trying to make it easier for people. That's a good word, right? We all like the easy button.
But if I don't get a referral for my primary care, my insurance may not cover the appointment.
Perhaps. It depends on your insurance. As far as we're concerned, as far as prolotherapy goes, we are waiving the idea that it has to come from the primary care, and
but
we're trying to fast track it.
May still require it.
Maybe.
Even if I'm planning on paying the $300 anyways.
Later on, yeah. Because the first shot won't be $300. You don't come right in for the shot. You come in for a consultation. So you just have to check with your insurance whether they need something to come from the primary care or not.
Who manufactures the injectable?
Who manufactures the injectable? The dextrose is manufactured by, I think, a company called Hospira out of Illinois. Dextrose is used a lot in the emergency room. Okay, or in ambulances, if any of you are paramedics, EMTs, you know about that. If someone's blood sugar crashes, they give them dextrose in their IV to lift them up. So it's a common med, typically found in the ER setting or in prolotherapy offices, interestingly enough. Yes?
Are there other prolotherapists in the community?
There are. There are some other people doing it. I don't know them personally, but from what I understand, I think down at Lynx Healthcare, which was formerly Pinnacle Pain, they do some prolotherapy as far as the neck and back and things like that. Yes.
Mm-hmm. What about the bunions on your feet that are painful?
What about bunions on your feet?
Can that be?
George, you want to talk about that?
Yes.
Great question. What about bunions? Can prolotherapy help bunions? I see you. We'll get you in a second. Go ahead, George.
Very quickly, I mentioned that my wife and I we like to do ballroom dancing. Well, because of her bunion, she wound up where we used to dance maybe 4 hours straight. She wound up dancing two or three dances, taking off her shoe, and I would see her rubbing her bunion. And one injection is all it took for that bunion pain to go away. And now she's back on the dance floor with me, and I don't see that shoe coming off that often. One injection.
Go. Yes. Can you say that again? I missed part of it.
An injury that is actually a tear.
Yeah.
Can you do this kind of a shot rather than have surgery? Or do you...
Good question. So she said, if you have an injury that is a tear, can you do this kind of shot rather than have surgery? Question is, what's the degree of that tear? So an example is your rotator cuff. If you have a quote-unquote full thickness tear of your rotator cuff, that means you have two ends that are flapping and not attached. That's going to need surgery. You can't do a shot and make them come back together, right? They're going to have to sew them back together. But if you have partial thickness tears of the rotator cuff, that's absolutely outstanding for prolotherapy. In fact, surgeons don't want to operate on that, right? Partial thickness tear, they're like, we're going to go in and cause more harm than good, right? Why are we going to cut around on something that's only half broken, right? So partial thickness tear is not an indication for surgery. The orthopedic will offer you typically a cortisone shot and therapy for a partial thickness tear. And prolotherapy is a great option for that. Let's go over here. Yes?
What is the success rate for knee cartilage?
Yeah, good question. Yep, it has a fairly good rate. So questions about success rate for knee arthritis. If your knee arthritis is very severe, right, it's going to bring down the effectiveness of the prolotherapy to a degree. because it's almost like the knee is too far gone at that point. So I do it, but I moderate the person's expectations a bit. If you're more like in a mild or moderate category with your knee arthritis, and the surgeon's like, the x-ray looks kind of bad, but it's way too early, you know, do the best you can, it's too early to put a knee replacement in you, then you're outstanding for prolotherapy because you're probably going to get a lot of relief. Knee arthritis and prolotherapy, that's the thing that has been most well studied, actually. There are the most high quality studies on that exact issue. They've compared it to basically just exercise or an injection of saline, which is just water essentially by itself, right? And they've done these studies several times. The exercise people kind of do mildly good. The saline people don't even really do that. And then the prolotherapy people go way up here and they're all happier. And that goes out to a year. So there have been several studies on that. We'll go way in the back. Yes. Yes,
You have not mentioned it previously.
They're probably with arthritis. Would you have considered that?
What kind of arthritis?
Wrist.
Oh, wrist. It's just not something I mentioned. The question is, can it help for wrist arthritis? Yes. And a lot of times the problem in the wrist isn't really the arthritis, which is the bones, it's the ligaments. You have tons of ligaments on your wrist, they can hurt. Can they get stretched? Can they tear? Yeah. Mm-hmm. So wrist ligaments is a big problem. Yes, go ahead.
If you're taking a blood thinner, can you get this injection?
From me, yes, you can, because we don't go deep into the spine with sensitive structures. The people who might do that would be like a lynx or a pinnacle pain, where it's almost like getting an epidural injection, if you've ever had one of those. So they use an x-ray machine, they're going down really deep in the spine. That can be helpful. I'm not saying that's not helpful, but there are many cases where it can be cured more simply with a surface injection. As it got started back in the 50s with Dr. Hackett, it was surface injections to the neck and low back. And that won't affect blood thinning status at all. Yes?
How does PRP compare to prolotherapy?
Good question. We're going to take one more question after this and we'll let people get out. So PRP is called platelet-rich plasma. It's a great injection. It's also another type of regenerative injection. It's very helpful. It's a similar concept. Instead of injecting dextrose to stimulate things, we draw your blood out of you and we spin down the platelets and concentrate it and inject it back into you. It also stimulates a powerful growth and healing response. It's very helpful. I'd say the differences are PRP is a little more of an involved process. Of course, taking blood out, spinning it, re-injecting it. It's therefore more expensive. So one Prolo shot, if you went to Seattle, Portland, $600 or $700. One PRP is probably $1,200 to $1,500. The PRP is more effective on a per dose basis. One shot of PRP is stronger, more powerful growth stimulus than one shot of prolotherapy. However, you can get to the same goal in the end. So I went to a national meeting. Top guy stood up, he does tons of PRP, he does tons of prolotherapy, and he flat out said, we can get to the same goal eventually. We might have to do three prolos or one PRP, you can still get to the same place. It depends on how quickly you want to get there and how much money you want to pay to get there. That's it. Okay, last question. Yes, way back.
You talk about regenerating.
Yeah.
The PRP regenerates more or less or the same?
More for a given shot. It is more potent. Okay, lovely. Thank you. I'll be around for about 10 more minutes.